This is the third video, almost done. This video is going to talk about ratification, how you actually made the Constitution go into effect, talk about Federalists and Anti-Federalists, and conclude with a brief discussion on the Bill of Rights. So we talked about what was actually in the Constitution earlier. And as we can see, the Constitution was passed back in the Constitutional Convention in 1787, but now it needed to be ratified. When I say that, I mean approved by at least 9 out of the 13 states in order to go into effect. The Constitution actually says this. You need to get at least 9 out of the 13. But you really need all 13 states, right? Because remember, you need all 13 states saying, okay, we're done with the Articles of Confederation. This is the new document that will bind the 13 states together. Spoiler alert, it did go into effect partly in 1788 and then all the way in 1790. I'll explain the difference between these two dates in a second. But it took a lot of convincing for that to happen. Okay, so you get Federalists, right? We'll talk about this earlier. Alexander Hamilton, James Madison, John Jay, George Washington, Ben Franklin. These are Federalists. These are people who believe in the new U.S. Constitution. They believe that it is an effective means of ensuring a federal form of government, right? Where you have shared power in a national government, but still states have their rights too, and states can govern themselves effectively. So they named themselves the Federalists. They were opposed, however, by the Anti-Federalists, George Mason, whose head I accidentally cut off, George Clinton, Patrick Henry, to name a few. Why are these guys represented by Michigan and these guys Ohio State? Sorry to the Michigan fans, but like Ohio State always wins, right? And in this case, the Federalists really basically won the debate over ratification between these two groups, right? So when the Constitution is out there and they're trying to convince the states to ratify it, you get something known as the Federalist Papers. This actually pure genius political thought book, a collection of 85 essays written in the span of 6 months by three ardent Federalists, Alexander Hamilton, the most famous of them all, James Madison, the future president, and John Jay. They basically wrote a bunch of articles. We don't have time to get into it now, saying like, look, here's why you should get rid of the get rid of the articles and embrace the Constitution. It had, among two other reasons, according to these writers, two main purposes. One, it's going to defend political minorities against majority tyranny. If you're worried about a king, which again, many colonists were at this time still, this fresh images of King George III are in their head, the Stamp Act, the Intolerable Acts, the new Constitution guards against that. And also, if you're worried that the Constitution won't be able to get anything done, according to the authors of the Federalist Papers, it's going to prevent stubborn minorities from blocking the will of the majority. And this is where Hamilton, Madison, and Jay, who are well-versed in political thought, in the works of Locke, the Spirit of Laws, Montesquieu, they're just really, really smart guys. Hamilton writes Federalist number 85, James Madison number 10. I don't have time to talk about them here, but really smart documents that say, hey, embrace the Constitution. And the states did. As you can see here, these are the dates of ratification. Delaware, the first to ratify the new Constitution, almost right after it was passed. And eventually, on June 21st, 1788, New Hampshire became the 9th state to ratify. So the Constitution does go into effect here. But look, you have Virginia and New York, two of the largest states in the 13 colonies who have not yet embraced the Constitution. They do shortly afterwards. And eventually Rogue Island, right, on 1790 becomes the last. And you have all 13 states who officially embrace the Constitution and say, okay, let's get this new form of government in place. 1789 also, when George Washington is elected president. So that's the ratification. That's kind of how it went. Big point, though, to remember, even though the Anti-Federalists lost, right, like Michigan frequently does, the debate over ratification, their long-standing concern over federal infringement led to the creation of a Bill of Rights. That is the first 10 amendments to the U.S. Constitution. Anti-Federalists in many of the states, especially parts of Western New York and Pennsylvania, rural areas, they were still worried about a new federal government and how they might exert too much power. In short, they didn't think power would be shared, right? They didn't think that federalism would actually work. They thought that a new government would impose its rights over the states. So the new federal government, right, which now includes a bicameral legislative branch and an executive branch and a judicial branch, with jurisdiction over all 13 states, had new powers to tax, had a president more likely to pass laws. The states are like, that was kind of weird. They're freaking out, right? They think, yikes, we're still nervous about this. The Federalists say, chill, right? Relax. Here's a Bill of Rights to ensure that the federal government doesn't overreach. So this was the kind of the biggest lasting legacy of especially George Mason, the Anti-Federalist. They wanted a Bill of Rights to ensure that the government won't impose anything that they don't like. And also George Washington is the new president. He won't turn into a king because, again, he was so well respected. What did the first 10 amendments look like? Here's a list of them. All were proposed on September 25th, 89, went into effect in 91, all on the same day. The famous freedom of religion, speech, and the press, the right to bear arms. Congress, or now the new Constitution, would protect the rights to life, liberty, and property. And also 9 and 10, again, textbook definitions of federalism and of sovereignty. Other rights are kept by the people, and undelegated powers kept by the states and the people. If the new legislative branch doesn't have the power to do something, that power is reserved and stays with the states.